Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. At the risk of using unfortunate phraseology, Arctic sea ice has been a hot topic for many years now. The Arctic's often called the world's air conditioning system because of the pivotal role it plays in controlling the planet's climate, largely due to the enormous ice sheet sitting on top of Greenland and the vast body of sea ice that ebbs and flows in the Arctic Ocean. So if those two bodies of ice start to diminish, then you can expect the air conditioning effect to change as well. There seems to be a constant debate about accuracy of measurement up in the Arctic. The implications of single year anomalies in the data set get disputed, as does the accuracy and calibration of different measuring instrumentation, margins of error in climate modelling, and value differences in calculating techniques from one monitoring agency to another. But really speaking, it doesn't matter which organisation you prefer, or which data set you choose to use from one year to another, or even which graph or chart you find easiest to read. My personal favourite is Jim Pettit's spiral graph, by the way. The trend line on every single reputable Arctic sea ice data set, graph and chart is an inexorable trajectory downwards towards zero. And when I say zero, I should probably clarify a couple of important caveats. The first is that zero in climate science terms means an extent of ice that's less than 1 million square kilometres. And the second is that there's no suggestion that this will be a year-round phenomenon, at least not in the short term anyway. It's likely that the first time we get an extent of ice that's less than 1 million square kilometres, it'll stay that way for a couple of weeks towards the end of September before building back up again when the colder months start to encroach. But the heat that will have got into the water while that ice was missing will make it extremely likely that once we've had a blue ocean event, we'll continue to get them every year thereafter. And there's an understandable human curiosity that drives the climate science community to try to make predictions about when that zero mark might actually be reached. At one extreme end of the prediction scale, 2017 was touted by some as an almost guaranteed date for the first blue ocean event. Right up until the 2017 minimum actually arrived and the sea ice bottomed out at about 4.7 million square kilometres. At the more conservative end of the scale, organisations like our own UK Meteorological Office point to the slowdown in the Atlantic meridional overturning current as an indicator of a much longer timeline, perhaps the end of the century. Conversely, the American Geophysical Union, or the AGU, has just released a new report pointing to a long-term warming phase in the tropical Pacific, which they suggest may mean a blue ocean event could occur in the next 20 years or so. Others use different extrapolations of graph trends to hit various possibilities. This graph of pyre mass measurements from 1980 to the present day has no fewer than 5 different overlay fit lines, including a straight linear trend line, an exponential fit, a second order polynomial fit, a log fit, and even something called a Gompertz fit. Pick your favourite line on this graph, and you can have a blue ocean event anywhere from about 2024 to 2050. All of that's fascinating stuff, if a bit frustratingly confusing for the non-scientific onlooker. But attempting to put our finger on when in the next 80 years this blue ocean event is likely to descend upon us is perhaps distracting us all from the real question, which is what will happen after a blue ocean event, and what can we do now to mitigate the worst effects? So this video contains no predictions from an English layman about blue ocean event timelines. Instead, we're going to have a look at the inextricably interconnected nature of the Arctic and its local environments and the wider global climate to establish the top 10 most significant potential outcomes of an ice-free Arctic. Consequence number one is to do with latent heat. As we discovered a couple of weeks ago, as long as there's ice in a body of water, then any surrounding heat energy is carried towards the ice to try and make it melt. But the energy needed to make it change state or phase from solid ice to liquid water is the same amount of energy that would heat an equivalent volume of liquid water all the way up to 79 degrees Celsius. So that's your first problem. Once all the ice is gone, the water gets much warmer very quickly indeed. And then you've got consequence number two, which is albedo change. Once all the ice goes, you no longer have a nice big sheet of reflective white stuff to bounce the sun's heat safely back out into space. Back in Programme 17, we did a little experiment with a digital thermometer, a couple of halogen lights, and some black and white card, and it was pretty obvious that the dark card was immediately absorbing loads more heat than the white card. And that's exactly what happens when ice disappears from the top of a dark blue ocean. So all that energy that was previously being reflected back by the ice will now be absorbed by the water. And that leads us to consequence number three, accelerated melt of the Greenland ice sheet. But hold on, I hear you say, the Greenland ice sheet is on land, not on sea, so it's a completely different thing, right? Well, yes, but the rapid warming of a continent-sized body of water right next to the landmass means that ambient air in the region will also be getting warmed up. That warmer air will be pulled inland and across the surface of Greenland, and it's this that will contribute to accelerating the melting of the ice sheet. Consequence number four, increase in water vapour. So we've got more liquid water from the melting ice, and we've got a warmer atmosphere because of the various feedback loops that we've just looked at. Physics tells us that for every 1 degree Celsius of warming, our atmosphere can hold about 7% more moisture. So now we've got more water vapour in the skies directly above the Arctic, and water vapour is itself a very potent greenhouse gas. As dense low clouds drape a warming blanket over the land and sea, we get ourselves one more feedback loop to add to the list. But because our global climate system is so interconnected, all that extra moisture in the air, coupled with the warmer atmosphere, also means a huge increase in energy and material to whip up storms, hurricanes, cyclones, and extreme flooding all over the world. We've already got just over a degree of warming compared to 1850 levels, and that's quite clearly having a big impact on extreme weather events around the world. According to a recent report from the World Meteorological Organization, most of the natural hazards that affected nearly 62 million people in 2018 were associated with extreme weather and climate events. 35 million people were hit by floods. Hurricane Florence and Hurricane Michael were just two of 14 $1 billion disasters in 2018 in the United States. Super Typhoon Mangkhut affected 2.4 million people and killed 134, mainly in the Philippines. Kerala in India suffered the heaviest rainfall and worst flooding in nearly a century. And all of that is without a blue ocean event. The regularity and severity of these things will most likely see a very rapid increase as a result of an ice-free Arctic. And all that extra water will also result in consequence number five, sea level rise. As water gets warmer, it expands, and as the Greenland ice sheet melts at an ever-increasing rate, that melting ice will flow down into the sea, and both those things together will result in rising sea levels, not just in the Arctic, but all around the globe. They're already rising as a consequence of human-induced climate change, of course, but after a blue ocean event, we'll stop talking in tenths of millimetres a year and start talking in tens of centimetres per decade or so. And then it won't just be hundreds of millions of people in vulnerable places like Bangladesh who suffer the loss of their homes and livelihoods, as well as famine, disease and premature deaths, something we've mostly become a bit numb to here in the West because it only really happens on the telly as far as we're concerned. No, no, now the water will be coming after us comfortable, affluent types as well. Most of the major cities and financial centres of the world are in coastal areas, and most of them face significant or even catastrophic disruption as water levels encroach on the lower-lying districts. Now, of course, there are some political leaders out there who wave a bit of bravado about and tell their citizens that they'll simply use human ingenuity and technology to keep the water out. Miami, for example, is already spending $500 million to install a massive pumping system to pump water back out into the ocean. And you know, good luck with that. Consequence number six, severe jet stream disruption. A blue ocean event will significantly accelerate the phenomenon known as Arctic amplification, for all the reasons we've just talked about. The Arctic has already warmed by nearly 2 degrees Celsius just over the last 30 years, much faster than the rest of the planet. And that's reducing the differential in temperature between the high latitudes and the equatorial region, and that causes the jet stream to slow down and meander about much more. We covered this in more detail in an earlier video that you can click up there to have a look at, but essentially a slower, more meandering jet stream drags colder Arctic air down to lower latitudes for prolonged periods of time, giving us things like the beast from the east that we got in Europe in the winter of 2018, and many of the severe cold snaps that North America has been suffering in the last couple of years. But crucially, it drags warm equatorial air much farther north, way up into the Arctic Circle, also for prolonged periods. So we witness ridiculously high temperatures like plus 11 degrees Celsius at the North Pole in September. And of course, that amplifies the Arctic warming still further and strengthens all the effects we've already looked at. Consequence number 7, methane. We've probably all seen headlines like the 50 gigaton methane bomb or the ticking time bomb of methane. So what's this all about, and where's this methane coming from, and why does it need to be included in this list of blue ocean event consequences? The 50 gigaton number was first brought to light by scientists specialised in analysing the East Siberian Arctic Shelf, or ESAS, as far back as 2008, during a European geophysical conference. This continental shelf is extremely shallow, only about 50 metres deep. In this 2013 paper, co-authored by Gail Whiteman, Chris Hope and Peter Wadhams, they explain, as the amount of Arctic sea ice declines at an unprecedented rate, the thawing of offshore permafrost releases methane. A 50 gigaton reservoir of methane, stored in the form of hydrates, exists on the East Siberian Arctic Shelf. It's likely to be emitted as the seabed warms, either steadily over 50 years or so, or suddenly. According to Professor Wadhams, even if only 8% of the methane was released, this would still very rapidly add about 0.6 degrees Celsius to our global temperatures, and rapidly rising temperatures will have a devastating effect on the main food-growing regions of the world. Which brings us to consequence number 8, global food crisis. Abrupt global warming will mean that these vital food-growing regions will begin to experience such severe and extreme temperatures and weather that agriculture will become practically impossible. This report in Time magazine summarises the predicament very well. Globally, we're reliant on a very slender thread of genetic diversity. According to the UN's Food and Agriculture Organisation, more than 50% of all human calories come from just three plants: rice, maize and wheat. And that rice, maize and wheat comes from these areas of the planet, all of which are going to be massively affected by climate change and global warming, especially following a blue ocean event. Our current human activity puts us on a path towards 4 degrees Celsius of warming by 2100, and the map of the world at that stage will look something like this. So the comfortable detachment and insulation we currently enjoy in the West will be pretty much shattered as we struggle to find enough food to feed our populations. Here in the UK, for example, we get 50% of our food from outside our country, much of which is sourced from these regions. And these huge swathes of once fertile land now turn to dust bowls, experiencing summer temperatures sometimes exceeding 50 degrees Celsius, will become places where human activity is more or less impossible. Which brings us neatly on to consequence number 9, climate refugee crisis. Here's some commentary from Lilja Alfredsdottir, Icelandic lawmaker and former Minister of Foreign Affairs of Iceland, in a NATO report from 2017. The refugee crisis, shaking political stability throughout much of the Middle East and posing serious problems in Europe, could be a harbinger of things to come. The huge economic and social costs linked to mass movements on this scale are self-evident. It is distinctly possible that global climate challenges could trigger mass movement, particularly in regions which no longer have the water and agricultural resources needed to support life. And that in turn leads to the final and arguably most frightening consequence in our list, consequence number 10, regional and global conflict. In that same NATO report, Philippe Vitel, a French legislator of the National Assembly, states, "It is a moral imperative to reduce hunger and thirst in the world, but it is also a strategic imperative. If the Middle East and North Africa cannot achieve sustainable food and water security, we will see many more crises in the years to come," he said. And Lilja Alfredsdottir concludes, "The potential for conflict between regions affected by climate change should not be ruled out." And that's ultra-conservative NATO speaking, not Greenpeace or Friends of the Earth. Of course, none of these consequences represents any kind of existential threat to the planet itself. Our Earth doesn't care what the temperature is or what the relative concentrations of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere are. Its self-regulatory systems have always recalibrated themselves over long periods of time so that eventually they always get back to equilibrium. The point is that for the last 11,000 years since the dawn of human civilization, we've been able to arrange our entire societal infrastructure in every corner of the globe around a remarkably stable and predictable climate with an average global temperature that's never varied by more than about 0.4 degrees Celsius in all of that time, until now. Our governments are perfectly well aware of what lies ahead, but they're not taking the radical actions necessary, partly in fear of the fossil fuel money that controls our modern political landscape, and partly in fear of inducing panic and unrest amongst their populations. So they need to be shown that their populations do want them to take radical action. That's the objective of groups like 350.org and Extinction Rebellion, and not forgetting, of course, the kids' school strike movement, inspired by the astonishingly determined and focused Swedish teenage activist Greta Thunberg. You might feel there's very little you can do as an individual to mitigate such an enormous issue, but that doesn't mean there's nothing you can do at all. If you feel it's within your gift, get involved with one of these groups, or at the very least, hassle your elected representative and don't take no for an answer. On a practical level, take your money away from those that are doing harm. Change your energy supplier to a green energy supplier, or better still, get solar panels on your roof. And don't give up if you're living in an apartment block. Get together with the other residents and sort out a communal system. That's already happening in many European cities. Change your bank, your life insurance, your pension provider if you've got one, to an organisation that's divested all its funds away from fossil fuels. We looked at that in more detail in Programme 10, which you can watch by clicking up there. If you can, get rid of your internal combustion engine car and walk or cycle wherever possible. And if you do need to have a car for mobility reasons or you've got five kids, then the next time you buy a new one, make sure it's an electric vehicle. Change your diet to minimise the amount of meat you consume, especially beef. A kilogram of beef is 30 times more impactful on the environment than a kilogram of plant protein. Ideally, move to a plant-based diet altogether. It's much cheaper and it's far healthier for you anyway. Each of us has a personal choice to make about how we respond to this climate crisis. I know a lot of you out there are already taking really positive actions of your own, so it'd be great to hear your news and views in the comments section below. That's it for this week though. Please do give us a like and a share if you found the program useful, and if you haven't already done so, do subscribe to the channel to keep up to date with all the latest content. It's absolutely free to subscribe and it really does help to raise the profile of the channel with the YouTube algorithm thingies so that more and more people can start getting the message. As always, thank you very much for watching, have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.